Now, how the scope will be? So, in this, if you consider the smart grid modernization, electric transmission and distribution infrastructure is which interconnects the generation at one end and consumers are at the other end. If you consider the transmission and distribution infrastructure, one side we are having the large generation stations are there, another side we are having consumers. So, but in the middle, what we are having, we have all the component systems which are in between, which includes distributed energy resources. Now we are considering distributed energy resources to make the system more smarter. Okay, what it is we will see in the next slides. And one more scope is EV is we want to accelerate the development and production of various electric drive vehicles. We want to accelerate the development as well as production of electric vehicles to substantially reduce the petrol consumption. Indirectly, we are reducing carbon emission. To reduce the carbon emission to meet clean air objective, so we are accelerating the EVs and PVs. Okay. So what is smart grid? So first we will see the basic. So a grid uses information and communication technology to acquire the data. It uses the information as well as communication technology to acquire the data and act on that information. So you understand, we are acquiring the data and it will act on the information about the behavior of suppliers, how the supply and how the consumer fashion. Okay, so here smart grid is generally it consists of applications in computers, intelligence, artificial intelligence, network abilities. Okay, so for the existing dumped electricity distribution system, what we want to do to make it smarter, we are using artificial intelligence and network abilities. That means indirectly we are using information technology and communication technology we are using to make our system, dumb electric system, to smarter electric system. So what we are doing, earlier what we were having, so one is the energy networks we are having, source generation is there, there is a transmission protocol and there is a distribution, these are the consumers we were having, this is the energy network. Now what we are doing to make the system smarter, we are using communication technology. So how we are using communication technology? Now we are merging energy networks with communication networks. So here, if we merge electrical network with the communication network, there are some advantages are there. Why we need to do the two-way communication? The reason is real-time simulation is possible throughout the network and wide area reliability. When earlier past grid, what we're having, there is no reliability on the system because there was only telephonic operator were there. Okay, so now what we are having by merging both communication network as well as energy network, then what we are having, real-time simulation throughout the network is possible and reliability will be wider. That means wide area reliability will be there. Then network optimization is possible. We can optimize the network and customer participation will increase. Stakeholders will be increasing obviously because of reliability, and we can participate in energy markets because we know the demand side management, how much is energy is available, where the deficit is there, where the surplus power is there. Based on that one, we can participate in energy markets by merging energy networks with the communication networks. So what is mainly we are having, by merging it, real-time simulation is possible, wide area reliability is improved, the network optimization is possible, customer participation is possible, will be improved, and we can participate in energy markets. Okay, so we will see basic earlier how the grid was, conventional grid. Now how we are changing into smarter. So earlier, as you know, that conventional grid was electromechanical, it was purely electromechanical and there was only one way communication. If there was any problem, so how it was happened? It was happened through either telephonic conversation. Okay, so and there was a centralized generation was there. Centralized generation in the sense, earlier there was only, in the past grid, it was only generation at one end only. It was centralized generation. There were no distributed generations. And we were having only few sensors were there. Manual monitoring was happened. And manual restoration, any problem is happened, the fault classification and location, rectification, entire restoration process was through manual only. either monitoring and controlling, everything was manual in the conventional grid. If the failures, there are chances of failures were very more, and the clearance also takes a lot of time. So it was limited control, and there were only, that is the reason it was, choice was very limited. So now what we are doing, we are converting conventional grid into smarter grid. So here what we are using, instead of electromechanical, we are using digital control. And now by matching energy networks with the communication networks, now one-way communication is becoming into two-way communication. So how is the two-way communication? All the places we are considering more sensors we are giving throughout the network. Throughout the network we are considering more sensors, so that what we are doing, we are acquiring the data, the information technology and communication technology. That's what I have told you earlier. So we are considering information technology and communication technology we are using for acquiring the data. Am I clear? So with the help of two-way communication, with the help of the communication network, we are acquiring the data, and based on the standards, so we are working on that data. So that means troubleshooting is happened here because of two-way communication. And even here, what we are doing in the smarter grid, earlier it was only centralized generation was there, now there is a distribution generation is happening in the transmission distribution level throughout the network. DGs are playing a major role, so that there is no need of extra generation, or there is no need of new power plants are required. So with a small amount of DG generation, it can be solved. And earlier it was manual, now self-monitoring and self-healing is possible. So that means we are considering fax devices, with the help of fax devices, harmonic eliminations, and all the things are, stabilization is possible, reactive compensation, everything is possible. So, and again with a smarter grid, it is adaptive, and islanding condition also it can work. It is a fully controlled, a pervasive controller. Now because of these are all advantages, the many customers, they are giving their choice to be part of the smarter grid. I hope you understand. So smart grid is digital, it is two-way communication. Throughout the network, we are using the sensors, and anywhere you can consider distributed generations, at that generation, transmission, distribution, wherever the level. Earlier it was a centralized, now it is distributed. Self-monitoring and self-healing is possible. It is an adaptive control, and it is becoming the many customers' choice. This we will see over you. The past, how the past grid was. So here too you can see, this is orange indicates power flow line diagram, and this dotted lines indicates information flow. There are two are there, one is a power flow, second one is information flow. So now, so here if you see, if you observe, there is a generation, transmission, distribution, and here there is a load. So the generation was through non-renewable sources or conventional sources, which was a thermal. Okay, the generated power, the centralized generated power was transmitted through a transmission line. Okay, so conventional generated power is transmitted to a transmission lines. Okay, so here there was a substation was there, and after that it is stepped down and it is distributed through a distribution transformers. Okay, so there we were having residential loads and the commercial loads, industrial loads will be there. Now the generation was only at centralized, and it is transmitted and distributed through a transmission network and distribution network. And how the, if there is any problem is happened, how the information flow, it was a telephonic concentric, or it is a telephonic centric. How it is, it is, so it is just through the phone calls they used to take the data. It was not automatic control, it was a manual control. Okay, earlier if there was a problem, then what was happened, it took more time to restoration. Now coming to the present, earlier it was only conventional energy was there. Now what we are doing, non-conventional energy sources, right, renewable energy sources we are considering. So if you take generation, not only conventional power, we have introduced clean power, which is wind and PV, we have introduced at the generation. Not only at the generation, at the receiving end or at the consumer level. So what we have considered, we have already considered PV systems and EV networks also we have considered. Try to understand. At the generation, we have considered PV, wind also considered, along with the conventional energy. Along with conventional, non-conventional sources also we have considered. And the transmitted through the transmission network and distributed through the distribution network. Then, even at the receiving end, even at the consumer level, even at the consumer level, now people are considering at the present grid. Even we are considering rooftop PVs we are considering, as well as household EVs we have started considering. How the power information flow will be? Information flow will be through generation, transmission and distribution is happening, but here there is a SCADA system at present we are using. The supervisory controlling and data acquisition we started doing at transmission level and distribution level. So compared to past grid, now present grid is little bit better. But coming to the future grid, how it will be? In the future grid, not only conventional, non-conventional, like thermal, conventional power, non-conventional PV, wind is considered. Now even small hydropower also we are considering. Okay. So not only at generation level, now at the transmission level also EVs we are considering, EV charging station. Present, there is no EV. In the future, at transmission level, there will be an EV. At distribution level, there is an EV, as well as at consumer level also there will be an EV. So distribution generation is happening at transmission level, distribution level and consumer level also. Okay, not only that, in the future smart grid, we are mainly considering charging infrastructure is one aspect. That's what I told you starting, accelerated clean transportation. Clean transportation is either through PV, wind or EV, clean transportation of power is possible. Clean power is possible. It is non-conventional. Okay, clean power is possible. And one more thing, charging infrastructure we need to take care of first 21st century grid. The 21st century grid, what we are considering, not only conventional and non-conventional energy, we are also considering EV structure, we are considering at a transmission and distribution, at a consumer levels. Not only that, there is a storage, plays a major role. Okay. Storage also we are considering at transmission level and at the distribution level, we are also considering storage along with EVs and PVs. We are also considering a storage. And here, how the information flow will be? Generation, the transmission, and how much storage is there, how much charging infrastructure is there. Through all the systems, the communication networks will acquire the data. It is fully automated. So now, with the help of smart meters, we are considering phase measuring meters will be there. So by using advanced metering infrastructures, by using advanced information technology, so we are making system more smarter by considering EVs, PVs and charging infrastructure as well as storage. Okay. Earlier it was generated, transmitted and distributed, there were loads were there. Power flow, information flow was through system operator. At present system, generation, not only through the conventional, there is a non-conventional also there, and distributed, and here at residential also there is EV and PV is there. In the future, not only conventional, non-conventional, electric vehicles, EVs, here also we are considering transmission distribution. It is fully automated. Now, we will see first. So this is what the structure we have seen. Why we are going to the smarter grid? Reason is there are some limitations are there. What it is, we'll see. This is the generation. Generation, you see, either it was conventional. It is transmitted. And distribution is either commercial, residential loads. Today's grid limitations are consumers are lack of information. So what facilities we were having, or what facilities you have, or what are all the main incentives we are having. So consumers are lack of, first thing is information. So there is no user friendly, there is no information available to the remote areas. So consumers are basically lack of information, first thing. And second thing is utilities lack the mechanism to influence the consumer behavior. Limited clean power, limited energy storage. the main grid limitation, present grid limitations are consumers are lack of information first. What facilities we are having, they don't know. What incentives we are getting, they don't know. Okay, so there is a gap between the energy network systems and the consumers. Second one is, whatever the utilities we are having, utilities lack the mechanism to influence the consumer behavior. So suppose consumers are not that much interested, then how to influence the people with the help of the present infrastructure, the network, existing network. The second one, limited clean power, limited energy storage. Okay, so to avoid these limitations, we are going to consider essential elements of a smart grid. Deep energy efficiency is required, demand side management can be taken, grid intelligence need to be considered, clean power, electric vehicles, energy storage and PVs can be considered. Okay, to avoid these grid limitations, we are considering deep energy efficiency, demand side management has to be done, grid intelligence has to be considered, clean power, electric vehicles, PVs, energy storage can be considered. So by considering it, we can get the system smarter. How the deep energy efficiency, how we can improve the efficiency, cost effective steps has to be taken, high energy loads can be considered, HVAC loads has to be considered. Okay. Now, demand side management, how it was? Earlier it was through wired. Now we can consider wireless communication. In the demand side management, by considering wireless, it will be more faster and the failures are very less. And we need to use curtailable loads like ACs, washing machine, other things. Curtailable loads, what instruments you are using. So there should be some curtailable loads has to be considered. And smart metering infrastructure has to be considered. And we need to aggregate the intelligence what we have. That means we need to use the communication protocols, or we need to use the information technology. The softwares or the updation has to be, our network has to be updated. The restructuring of the power system has to be done. So by demand side management, first thing is to get that one better demand side management has to be done. One is the load scheduling, other things, everything should be done with the help of the wireless communication networks, right? We need to acquire entire data information, okay, through wireless networks. Second one is curtailable loads has to be considered. For that one, smart meters, smart metering infrastructure has to be considered. Our advanced metering infrastructure has to be considered. And we need to consider aggregate the entire intelligence, either information technology, communication networks, energy networks, all to be merged. And we need to do the demand side management. For that one, intelligence is plays a major role. How it is? We need to monitor and we need to control the entire network, and SCADA integration is required. Not only smart meters, synchro phase measuring units are required. The gas insulated substation has to be considered. So one more objective is clean power is not there. For that one, clean power, earlier what we're having, you see here, only conventional power was there. Now what we are considering for a clean power, if you observe here clearly, at utility also, PVs and wind we are considering at utility. At commercial level also, PV we are considering. That means all square PV we are considering. At utility, wind we are considering. PV and wind we are considering. But in the middle, we need to see now distributed generations also we are considering. So with the help of non-conventional energy sources or renewable energy sources, the clean power can be achieved. So one more thing. Present, we are using PVs. In future, even EVs also can be considered at transmission and distribution level as well as the commercial and residential level. So by considering it, oil consumption will be reduced. No need of depending on it. It is independent. But for this one, only drawback is charging infrastructure is plays a major role. So we need to see the charging infrastructure. Not only considering EV and PV, we need to see the better energy storage devices. Okay, so we need to consider EV and PV or whatever energy we are having, distributed energy sources we are having. So we need to consider energy storage. Okay. So by considering deep energy efficiency, demand side management, grid intelligence, clean power, electric vehicles, PVs, energy storage, we can make our entire network smarter. If you see in the future how it will be, main enabled applications are utility side. If you see demand response, microgrid, operation efficiency are main thing. So under that what we are having, home area network, plug-in electric vehicles, energy storage, distributed generation, these are all the things will come in. And for this one, mainly fundamental application what we need is for demand response, other things, smart meters are required. Demand side management is required. Distribution automation is required. Distribution management is required. And IT infrastructure, telecom infrastructure, circuit topology. These are all the things are required. But out of which, smart grid main first priorities, these are all the things are available to us. But at present, first smart grid policy priorities under this one is demand response, plug-in electric vehicles, energy storage, distribution automation, distribution management system, and substation automation. These are the primary, these are the main priorities under smart grid at present situation. So demand response we need to see. Plug-in electric vehicles we are considering. Not only considering the EVs, we are also considering the storage. Okay. Further that one, distribution automation, distribution management system, substation automation is required. Now, why we need to go for EVs? What benefits we will get? The first one is driving electrical vehicles, you can save more than 70% of fuel cost. That means you are reducing the carbon emission. So you can save the money. Second one is there is no tap pipe emissions. That means clear air or clean air is possible. Mostly it is LCT is made from domestic sources. So we are reducing dependency on foreign oil. That means we can support the energy independence. You can enjoy the ride. So you are saving the money, clean air we are doing, and you are independent. You are not depending upon the foreign oils. How many types we are having? So there is plug-in hybrid electric vehicles are there. Extended range of electric vehicles are available. Battery electrical vehicles we are having. Okay. So on an average per hour, 10 to 40 miles your vehicle can go per hour charging. 35 to 40 miles electrical car can go, and if you consider the extended range of batteries, even 300 miles it can go. I will show you the charging infrastructure, how it will be. Either it will be plug-in or extended range of electric vehicles or battery electric vehicles are available for us. Now, if you see, there are AC charging is there, there is a DC charging is there. If I consider AC charging, home charging can be possible, fleet can be possible, public use can be possible. Home in the sense at your home level, one or two vehicles you can charge. Fleet in the sense, if any organization or any institute or organization having maybe 10s or 50 or hundreds of vehicles are there, it is called group of vehicles is called fleet. Your institute or maybe one organization, maybe one company. So if it has the charging infrastructure, it is called fleet. Fleet is nothing but group of charging structure and public use anyway. Even public order, like how the petrol pumps are there, like public uses, even we can consider charging infrastructure. Either your vehicle can be charged at home, it may be at fleet is nothing but group of vehicles. Even if you have 5-6 vehicles, even fleet charging one place, dedicated place can be given, fleet. More number of vehicles can be charged at a time, or at your office or organization or at company, or it may be public use also. Again, it is AC charging is level 1, level 2 will be there. I will tell you what it is. Then DC fast charging, mostly DC can be considered when you have hundreds of vehicles are there. That means large fleet is there, then DC we will go because it is a high costly and high range. And public use only, we are going for that one. So when you consider AC charging, power ranges are available are 120 volts, 1.4 kilowatt, 12 amperes, or 120 volts, 1.9 kilowatt, 16 amperes. Now, how many miles you can go or how many kilometers you can go per hour of charge? To charge your vehicle 1 hour, how many hours you can go for 120 volts, 1.4 kilowatt charging infrastructure if you are having? So 1 hour if you charge, 5 miles you can go. 5 miles in the sense approximately 8 kilometers. So 21.6. If you charge for 10 hours, approximately 100 kilometers you can travel if you have 120 volts charging infrastructure at home. But if you have level 2, which is nothing but fleet level, let us consider level 2 charging infrastructure. If you are having, its voltage level is 240 volts, 19.2 kilowatt, 80 ampere structure if you are having. So maximum you can go up to 60 miles, 60 in the sense per hour charging it is. 1 hour if you charge vehicle, if the load is 19.2 kilowatts, for 1 hour of charge, 60 miles, that means 90 kilometers. If you have 2 hours of charge, 180 kilometers it will travel. Within 3 hours of charge, if you have 240 volts, 80 amperes and 19.2 kilowatt is there at fleet level, then just for 1 hour, 90 kilometers you can travel. Or if you 2 hours, if you charge, you can travel up to more than 180 or 200 kilometers. Okay. And if it is 3.3 kilowatt, only 14 miles or 6.6, based on the power ratings you consider, that much faster the charging can be done. It is for 1 hour of charge. Now, if you consider, this is for public use, mainly level 2 will be there. At home, level 1 will be there generally. So that's why overnight charge, you can go 100 kilometers. That's what people will say. Now, DC fast charging is available at only industry levels or institutions, organizations. So large fleet, wherever it is there, their DC charging is people are considering, or public uses. So how it is? Its range is 200 volts to 500 volts up to 40 kilowatt. Earlier it was AC charging is 120 volts or 240 volts. But DC charging is 200 to 500 volts, 40 kilowatt it is there. Okay. If it is 40 kilowatt, up to 120 miles, people can go per 1 hour of charge. If you charge your vehicle for 1 hour, you can go 120 miles. 120 miles into 1.6, more than, you can see, 200 kilometers. For 1 hour charge, you can go more than 200 kilometers. But at the same time, instead of this one, level 2 is 200 to 500 volts. Instead of 400 kilowatt of load, 100 kilowatt load is there. Sir, instead of 40 kilowatt, 100 kilowatt load and 200 amperes is there. Then you can travel for 1 hour, 300 miles. That means 480 or 500 kilometers. 1 hour if you charge 500 kilometers, you can travel. So if you have the charging infrastructure of DC charging infrastructure is there. For 1 hour of DC charging infrastructure, you can travel up to 500 kilometers. At household level, if you want to travel, overnight can be charged. If you have the institute level of AC is there, then 2 to 3 hours can be charged. At institute level or organization level, if you have 40 kilowatt range, then 200 kilometers, you have to charge just 1 hour. But if you have large fleet infrastructure or infrastructure of public uses, if it is of 100 kilowatt range, 1 hour charging 500 kilometers you can travel. These are the ranges based on the power ratings or current ratings, voltage ratings, VIP ratings, voltage and ratings. Then for 1 hour charge, there is a variations are there. It's you where you are charging based on that one. The kilometer range will be extended and cost and complexity tend to increase the faster charging. So these are the electric vehicles. Now if you see, there is a charging infrastructure here and there is a PV is there. here you have a PV. This is EV charging infrastructure. From here, what we are doing? We are charging our vehicle. Try to understand. This is a charging infrastructure. From the grid, we have taken. Let us consider. From here, you are charging your vehicle. But in future, earlier it was only this is the charging infrastructure. From grid, it was taken. And directly charging, it is leaving. There is a fleet of vehicles are there. 1, 2, 3. There are fleet of vehicles. There are more number of vehicles will be there. This is Tata. Okay. Electric vehicle charging is there. Now, earlier it was like this. Now, what people are doing, not only depending on the grid, now to the charging infrastructure, PV they are considering. They are integrating PV and EV. So, when there is a morning time, sunny is there, then what will happen? First, EV will be charged. The surplus amount of energy will be given to here. It is independent of energy. And it will be charged. When there is a surplus power is not there, that time only we are depending upon the grid. Okay. So we can, EV and PV can be merged through the grid for clean air. You see here how the emissions, the charging infrastructure points are there. This is by Tesla. The other one was by Tata. Now, as I told you earlier, how the charging infrastructure, here we will see it is divided into home charging, destination charging, opportunity charging. Home charging is either residential or fleet. At your home also, if you have 5 to 6 vehicles are there, even you can consider fleet. Or only residential level, only either AC 1, 2 can be considered. AC 1 is, AC level 1 is 120 volts. AC level 2 is 240 volts. Even at home charging, if you have more vehicles, not only AC, even DC of 200 volts charging infrastructure can be considered. But it is not cost effective, it will be costly DC. Destination charging. At workplace, you can charge. At workplace, either you will have AC level of 2 or DC level 1 will be there. Or maybe destinations, public use, it will be there. AC 2 and DC level 1. This is destination charging. Destination charging in the sense, at your office, workplace, or at the public uses, at other places. But opportunity charging is the retail, or corridors, other places, mostly public uses, mostly DC will be considered, not AC. Because if you consider DC, the fast charging rate will be faster. The person can charge his vehicle within half an hour, he can leave. So DC 2 charging, half an hour if he charge, then 250 kilometers he can travel. Okay, so that's the reason. So more than 80% of residential and fleet charging is done at home only. More than 80% at your regular use, for your regular use, hardly if you go 100 kilometers per day, then mostly 80% of residential and fleet charging is done at home only. Okay. And overnight charging, it can be possible for your personal vehicles. And sometimes what we will do, sometimes charging you will do at home. And if the charging infrastructure is available at your organization or at your office, not only at home, you are also using fleet vehicles at workplace. Okay, even workplace charging is possible and even mass adaptation is possible. We'll see. So how the myths are there. So now plug-in electric vehicles can only support short trips, not the daily commutes people are talking. But it is not true. Average it is giving 40 miles, okay, means 60 kilometers approximately it is giving. And if you use the battery enabled, then even it can give 100 miles. Okay, and even you can extend up to 300 miles. Tilling is not clean compared to the present emissions of your power plants. No? Compared to this, the emissions are very less. People will say the bill is increasing, our energy bill will increase, it will go up. But the thing is, electric vehicles, no? You are getting so many incentives. If you compare with that incentives, it is cheaper only. I'll show you what is incentive. You see, in India, the government of India has given, provided one scheme, electric vehicle adaptation. What is that? We will see. there is a FAME India scheme is there. What it means? Faster adaptation of manufacturing hybrid electric vehicles. There is a scheme is there. Faster adaptation of manufacturing hybrid electric vehicles is there. Am I clear? The government of India has given one scheme. Why this scheme has come to the picture? Reason is with an objective of to support hybrid as well as normal electric vehicles, okay, in the market for development and manufacturing the ecosystem. Okay, so objective is to support hybrid or to support the production of hybrid electric vehicles. The reason is, main reason is, our motto is clean air objective. To meet the clean air objective, a clean electric power transportation. So what incentive is given? They have provided one scheme. So when it was launched in actually the EV industry, but it is happening in 2013. It started with, its target was 6 to 7 million. Number was actually one was started in 2013, but the thing is actual implementation was happening. Actual implementation was started in 2015. Actual implementation was started in 2015, but actually with a duration of 2 years they have started. But the thing is, within 2 years they have not reached that much goal. So that is the reason they have extended, and up to March 2019 the first frame of scheme was completed. Now we have, from March 1st 2019 onwards, last year onwards, there is a FAME 2 scheme has started with an outlay of 10,000 crores. They had given, they have provided the fund. 10,000 crores is there outlay of for a period of 3 years. Okay, this 10,000 crores will be given as incentives for promoting electric vehicles. Okay, now we'll see. FAME 1, what has started? So FAME is nothing but faster adaptation of and manufacturing of electric vehicles in India. It is launched in 2011 under NEMP plan, okay, and unveiled in 2013. But actually, it started in 2015 implementation. The scheme is encouraging the progress of reliable, affordable, and efficient electric vehicles. Okay, as I told you, first phase was started in 1st April 2015. Initially, the period was given for 2 years, but actually, what happened? The scheme has extended from time to time. Okay, it allowed up to 2019. So what you have considered under the digitalization of the schemes, or Digital India scheme, you may call it as, or Digital India, Skill India, under the Digital India scheme, the efficiency, transparency with effective monitoring, FAME India has launched, this is the website, has launched one website, and all the policies, all the like incentive details, all the purchase details, everything is available in this website. Okay, so at present there are 30 OEMs are there, original equipment manufacturers are there. That means the people, original equipment manufacturers are there, are 30 are there, and the models are 137 are there. Try to understand, there are 30 manufacturing equipment or companies are there, and 137 models are there, electric vehicles, okay, in all categories, like it may be buses, four-wheeler, three-wheeler, two-wheelers, okay. So there are 137 models are available in electric vehicles. What is that models also we will see, okay. Till now, in the first phase, as I told you, first phase was just initiation was happened in 2011 under NEMP plan. 2013 it is unveiled, and 2015 it has started. By 2019 March it has closed. Under the first phase, total amount disbursement was happened 359 crores only, even though 10,000 crores were allotted. 359 crores only incentives are given, or it may be collected by the people. So how many vehicles they have purchased? 2.8 lakh vehicles were purchased under FAME India up to 2019, the first scheme. Okay, 2.8 lakh vehicles were purchased in all over India. Why? By using electric vehicles. Why they have promoted clean air, as we told? So how we can say it is a clean air? So they have measured by usage of electric vehicles. So how much fuel they have saved? So total expected fuel saved due to electrification is about 50 million liters they have saved. That is energy independent, as I told you. 50 million liters of they have saved per day approximately on an average in India. This 2.8 lakh vehicles, 52,000 liters per day we are saving. And is 1.3 lakh kgs it is reduced. So greenhouse emission is possible. Clean air objectives we have achieved by promoting faster adaptation of EVs. Okay. Now MIS details are available. If you see, 1.8 lakhs I told you, no? Just this photo was taken a little bit earlier, 1 month prior to that. Total number of vehicles sold, just 1 week prior I have taken earlier, 2.66 it is showing. At that time, so by state wise or place wise, you see, state wise, how many purchased? You see Maharashtra, 34,000 are there. Maharashtra, there are 34,000 vehicles are there. In Andhra, there are 9,600 vehicles were purchased up to 2019. Okay, so state wise, so if you open this website, so even if you click on this arrow mark, how many four wheelers, how many three wheelers, that details also will be available. You can see that. Okay, so this is state wise distribution. If you click here, even the vehicle wise, model wise distribution also available. You can see that. And one more thing, for which model, how much incentive also it is available. I will show you. Now, this was FAME 1, under FAME 1 scheme up to 2019. Now, this is the FAME 2 scheme. This is FAME 2. Now, 2019 it has started. 1st April 2019 it has started. New financial year. 2019 they have started with an outlay of 10,000 crores. With an outlay of 10,000 crores they had provided, approved, government has approved 10,000 crores under this scheme for a duration of 3 years. 3 years. In this scheme, what their expectation is, so they want to give incentives, at least they want to support 7,000 e-buses. They want to support for 7,000 electric buses, 5 lakh three-wheeler vehicles, electric three-wheelers, 55,000 four-wheeler passenger cars, 55,000, and 10 lakh two-wheelers. So they want to promote 7,000 electric buses, 5 lakh three-wheelers, and 55,000 four-wheeler cars, and 10 lakh two-wheelers they want to promote. Okay, so total budget is 10,000 crores for a period of 3 years. So till now, how many were purchased from 2019? I will show you the data. Actually, models available are 60 models only. Earlier in the first phase, 137 models are available. So that many, 30 different companies have provided, and 137 models were available. But in FAME 2, only 60 models are available at present. Last 1 year, within 1 year, 1.5 year, total number of vehicles sold are 26,000 were sold, and claimed are 134, and 71 crores has given as incentive amount. Now you see here, this is was how much fuel was saved, per day how much, carbon how much reduced, total and per day. Now you see, in the under FAME 2 scheme itself, Maharashtra 3192, Andhra 690, and there are numbers. If you click here, the data will come. I will show you. So you click on the website. Let me show you. Okay, so there will be a website will be open. 1 minute. So this is the website. This data is not mine. These are the details. And now you see here. Suppose this one only you see Maharashtra. Let us consider, you click here. You click here. Vehicle type Maharashtra. Four wheelers, 245 four wheelers out of 3245 four wheelers were purchased. Three wheelers are two. That's the two L5M. And three wheeler rickshaw are 57. Two wheelers are 2800, total 3193. If you see, in Andhra, 693 are there. In frame 2, four wheelers are 1. Four wheelers are 1, two wheelers are 2, that L2 type. And three wheelers are 69, there are L1 type, 462. So, individual how many were purchased, entire data will be there. You can go through the website. Next, coming to here, what models we are having, I will show you. 1 minute. See, I hope the screen is visible to you. See, under original manufacturers, see electric vehicle manufacturers, the Ampere Vehicles Private Limited. They have Geel model is there, two wheeler. Magnus is there. Geel VXN1 is there. Geel CA is there. These are all comes under L1, L1, L1 type. Incentives they are giving 18,000 per vehicle. And if it is this model, Geel model, 90,600 is given as incentive amount. This amount will be given by the government if you purchase this vehicle. You see, if you want details, that vehicle details, what is the range, kilometers, how much it can go, what is the maximum speed, how much acceleration, the entire details are, 1 minute. Entire details are, you can see here. Okay, now coming to another Ather. So they had given L2 type, even the amount it is given, incentive amount. In the same way, you see three wheelers, 37,000 they are giving. Even three wheeler of the champion, this one, L5M, 66,000 they are giving. You can see here, if you type here, if you click here, the vehicle details you can see. In the same way, you will see just four wheeler how much they are giving. In four wheeler, 1,59,000. Some models they are giving even 2 lakh. Even buses we can see at the last. Bus details are available. Buses are there. Two wheeler, three wheeler, four wheeler, even four wheeler buses are there. So each and every model there is vehicle category is there. The cost will be there. If you want details, you can go through it. Okay. So this is the data what we have. So what I want to say is, so in 2011 it was initiated under NEMP plan, Clean Air Objective. even it is initiated 2011, 2013 it has started. Actually, unveiling was happened in 2013. EV mission has started in 2013. So the main motto is the fast adaptation of electric vehicles. So 2015 they have started manufacturing, or the FAME I scheme has started. So it was not leaked that much. Starting they had given 2 years only. So because of the customers, they have not reached, like customers lack of information. That's what happened earlier. So because of that, they what they did, they have extended the years up to 2019. So total of 359 crores incentives they were given, and 2.8 lakhs only were sold. So second phase, this is FAME II. Now last year it was started, the target is, they have set the target as, this is what the target. What the target is, they want to support 7,000 buses, 5 lakh 3 wheelers at least, 55 4 wheeler cars, and 10 lakh electric exclusively bikes they want to promote. This is what they target. So that's why, so more they want go with the customer interaction, they want to go, and they want to give more incentives. They want to promote even electric vehicles more under Digital India scheme. Am I clear? So that's why 10,000 crores were allotted for the next 3 years. Okay, for the maybe last 2019 to 2022. Okay, these are the vehicles sold. Clear? So now we have, because of these many incentives what we have, because of this much of the support from the government, so definitely cost of electrical vehicles may be reduced. How it is? Because if you purchase any vehicle, the based on the model and type, and based on the kilometers range, the incentive amount they are giving, so there is, it is not overburdened, because government is sharing some part, it is giving the incentive, so it is cost effective only. Okay, and one more thing, now they are working on, earlier they have worked on only, they had given electric vehicles, now they are working on charging infrastructure also. So by working on charging infrastructure, they are trying to provide the charging infrastructures. So how it will be, for that one they need fleet way, like coming and going way, and there are charging AC, DC, both levels are required. So now they are concentrating on charging infrastructure. So if it is user friendly charging infrastructure within within 10 kilometers they would like to provide. So within 10 kilometers they are starting it. If they do that, then what will happen? The faster the sales will happen. These are the, at present, these are the incentives given by the Government of India for promoting the electric vehicles. That's why scheme name also, faster adaptation and manufacturing of electric vehicles, they have named it. Okay, now go with this one. What will happen? What are V2X technologies? We will see. Now, the V2X is nothing but V2X replaced with X, replaced with either with the G, L, V or H. What it means? V2G is possible, V2L is possible, V2V is possible, V2Home. What it means? Vehicle to grid is possible, VTX communication or VTX technology is, vehicle to grid is possible, vehicle to load is possible, vehicle to vehicle, vehicle to home. So here there are two things are there. One is pure bidirectional, pure unidirectional. Now if you consider the vehicle to grid is possible, grid to vehicle also possible. Okay, so V2G technology is bidirectional. Now coming to the vehicle to load, it is unidirectional. Vehicle to vehicle, bidirectional. Vehicle to home, also bidirectional. Only vehicle to load is unidirectional. Now, with the vehicle, if you have surplus amount of power is there, what we will do, we will aggregate, like free charging is there, let us consider. If you have an apartment structure you are having, if you have hundreds of cars are there, hundreds of cars, energy is aggregated together, that surplus amount of power can be transferred to your apartment. That's called smart apartment. Okay, so vehicles to the apartment or vehicle to home is possible, home to vehicle also possible. If you have surplus amount of power with your vehicle, So aggregation of the powers can be done, and it can be sent to the either grid or grid to vehicle anyway, general concept. Suppose in any vehicle is, suppose if any electrical vehicle is in need of battery charging, vehicle to vehicle charging also possible with power line conductors. Suppose if I go with the, let us consider islanding condition you take. That's what smart grid. In islanding condition also it plays a major role, I told you in the first slide. How it will work as an islanding condition? Like if you take one remote site is there, where there is no power supply at all. There is no chance of taking anything. In that place, what we can do, from your vehicle, you can give small amount of vehicle to load, it is possible. Where the remote areas are there, there it will act as a generator. Vehicle to home is possible, home to vehicle also possible. Okay, first we will see. If we consider vehicle to grid, what is advantage? Vehicle to load, what advantages? We will see individually one by one. Okay, so first one. What I am doing, vehicle is there. I am connecting it to grid. So when you are connecting, you try to understand single vehicle you are not connecting. You keep in mind one thing, aggregation of vehicles, that means there are group of vehicles, there are group of vehicles connected together. One second. Sorry. So vehicle to grid, how we are doing is, there are group of vehicles or aggregation of vehicles will be done first. What we will do, there are fleet electric vehicles, there are hundreds of vehicles we will be taking. Then what we will do, the hundred of vehicles were interconnected or maybe connect, grouping will be done, clustering will be done at one place. Then that entire energy will be taken, that energy will be sent to the converters. Then DC-DC converter power will be enhanced. And the inverter will be used and it will be sent to the integration. Now group of vehicles, keep in mind, it is not single vehicle. Vehicle to grid, if you want to do, you are not doing with a single vehicle, you are doing with the group of vehicles. Aggregation of the power will be sent through the V2G technology. And what is that V2G technology, how it will happen, I will tell you, I will show you next slide. So group of vehicles, excess power will be sent to the grid. If you have excess power, you can send it to the grid. By sending it, what will happen is, vehicle to grid, if you do that, what will happen? The reduce in the peak power demand, whenever the peak power demand is there, during peak load conditions, if I supply the power, we are reducing the peak power demand, okay? And we are, with this one, what is happening? We are enhancing the grid stability, reliability and security. That's not our main objective. The reliability has to be improved and security has to be improved. System should be stabilized. Reliability is improving, security improving, and system will be stabilized. Whenever a surplus power is required, surplus power is there, it is giving. And whenever the deficiency is there in the grid, it is able to reduce the peak power demand. And better integration is possible with the renewable sources. How the better integration? EV and PV can be connected together and it can be given. And renewable energy storage is possible. It provides the grid services. It is highly independent. It is not depending on the oil or an oil. It is highly independent structure. And by considering it, we are decreasing the investment on new power plant. Try to understand, whenever the need is there in the grid, with help of EV aggregation, we are reducing the peak power demand. With that one, we are achieving the stability. With that one, reliability is improved and security is improved. And grid services we are doing, what is that grid services, we will see in the next slide. And better integration of renewable energy also possible. This is entire thing is highly independent. So with this one, what is happening? Decreasing the investment on new power plants. By decreasing new power plants and by giving the more power, we are generating the revenues. How we are generating? By wholesale power market participation. We are participating in the wholesale power market. Okay, now vehicle to load if I consider. What is vehicle to load? Vehicle to load is nothing but whenever there is an emergency is there. Whenever there is an emergency plant is there, then there it acts as a generator outage. When there is an outage is there, it will act as a generator. Same, it is an highly independent. It provides the power in remote areas. It provides the power in remote areas where there is an emergency need is there. It acts as a generator and self-consumption. Okay. Vehicle to home is a green. Vehicle to home. Vehicle to home is, if you see vehicle to home, if I connect my vehicle to the one particular purpose, if I consider, what will happen? Self-consumption I am doing. I am not depending upon any new power plant addition. So decrease in the investment on new power plants. There is no load is not increased on the grid. Suddenly load is increased at home or whatever it may be. That load will be stabilized with the help of EVs. With that one, decrease in the investment of new power plants, it generates the revenues. And one more thing, that rooftop PV is there. The better integration of EVs and PVs also possible. Renewable energy storage is possible, highly independent. And one more thing, when there is no power supply, won't be any disconnectivity. There will be a connectivity will be there. So your EV will act as generator when there is an outage. Try to understand. First thing is, whenever the load is increased at your home, you no need to depend upon, there won't be any overburden on the grid. Directly, it is able to give self-consumption is possible. It is highly independent. You are not depending on the grid for excess load. And when there is a disconnectivity of grid also, then one is when there is a connect, it is connected to grid, load is increased, it will stabilize the energy. Even when there is no power supply grid connection, it will act as a generator. Okay. Self-consumption is possible, decrease in the investment of new power plant is possible, and which generates the revenues, obviously. And better integration with PVs. That is also possible. If you consider vehicle to vehicle, generally, if you see vehicle to vehicle to vehicle, when there is a help is needed, then it helps the other EVs. Okay, efficient EV parking is possible. That means wherever you want, there you can go, and with the another vehicle, suppose there charging infrastructure is not available, you are at remote place, one more EV you can take, fully charged vehicle, you can charge it, you can come back. There is no need of running there, getting the vehicle, fuel, other things, nothing is required. One more vehicle will be there. If you have, then directly, which helps the EVs, efficient EV parking and management can be possible. Efficient EV parking management possible and self-consumption. Second thing is, it is highly independent. So EV to EV or electric vehicle to vehicle is possible. Okay. So what is possible? First thing, once again, vehicle to grid is possible with that one. Reduce the peak power demand, and we are participating in wholesale market. You can generate the revenues and decrease in the investment of new power plants. One, we are generating the revenue. Second one is, there is a decrease in the investment of new power plants. There also amount is generated. We are not wasting the amount. And second thing is, by reducing the peak power demand, a low shaving or low peak shaving or peak sharing, then what has happened? Grid stability is improved, reliability is improved, security is there. Better integration is possible, highly independent. Vehicle to load, when there is an emergency, then it is acts as a generator, highly independent, it provides power to the remote places and self-consumption. We consider vehicle to home, when grid is connected, load is increased, that time also you can give from here, that there is no extra burden on the grid. Second thing is, when there is no power supply, it acts as a generator, highly independent. And even integration of with renewable sources is possible. EV PV integration, rooftop PV with EV is possible. And there is a we can generate the revenues, and there is a decrease in the investment of new power plants. Definitely, stability, reliability and security will be improved of household level. Vehicle to vehicle, if I consider, we can help other vehicles. Self consumption is possible. Efficient EV parking management is possible. Highly independent. So because of these reasons, the government is giving more incentives to on promoting hybrid electric vehicles under the fast adaptation of manufacturing electric vehicles scheme, FAME scheme. Okay. Now, I want to go with vehicle to grid. How it should be? Now you see, I want to connect the vehicle to grid. If I consider vehicle, don't think like it is a single vehicle. It is a group of vehicles, aggregation of vehicles. Aggregation of vehicles, I have DC power. So what I need to do, vehicle to grid I am doing is reverse. You try to understand reverse. Vehicle to grid I am doing. Vehicle will have DC power. So small amount of DC is there. I will use the better DC-DC converter. Try to understand here. I will use the best DC-DC converter topology in such a way that whatever the power is generated here, the DC to DC conversion can be done. We are boosting up the voltage. After boosting up here, voltage source inverters are considered. Then what I will do, the amount of DC is available here, it will be again converted back to AC. One time conversion we are doing, small amount of DC to high amount of DC, and the small amount also, because of not single vehicle, it is because of aggregation of vehicles will be there. Try to understand. See here, there are aggregation of vehicles will be there connected to one junction point. This aggregated power will be connected to the grid. But before connecting, the stage is, so this aggregated power is DC power is boosted up with the help of DC-DC converters. Then after that, the inversion will be happen DC to AC, then which will be connected to the grid level. This is vehicle to grid. When there is state of charge is more, SOC is more than 70%, is vehicle to grid is possible. If I want grid to vehicle, same way. High amount of AC is there. AC to DC conversion we will do. First of all, AC power will be there. AC to DC we will do. And high amount of DC will be, it is step down, or buck converter will be used, then stepping down is connected to the electric vehicles. So it is a bidirectional process, either grid to vehicle is possible, vehicle to grid is possible, both ways it is possible, based on state of charge of vehicle. Okay. In the same way, power flow diagram for vehicle to home will be how much it will be, what will be, if I remove here grid, if I replace with home, how it will be? Vehicle, same way, DC to DC conversion, DC to AC conversion. If it is a power grid, it is in terms of 11 kV. If it is a household purpose, 240 volts of phase voltage. Industry level, 400 volts. Am I clear? So vehicle to home is possible. Same structure you replace, but the power levels are different. Power levels will be different. Vehicle to grid is possible, grid to vehicle possible. Home to vehicle possible, vehicle to home is possible. Vehicle to apartment structure, vehicle to apartment to vehicle structure is possible. And one more thing, vehicle to vehicle, if I want to consider, there is only one level of conversion will be there. Only vehicle to vehicle directly power line connect can be considered. There is no converter structures. DC-DC converter not required. DC to AC converter is not required. Vehicle to vehicle, if I consider, power flow diagram will be vehicle to vehicle is only single power line carrier will be there. So it's a vehicle to load, yes, based on either it is AC or it is DC. If it is a DC, only single converter will be there. If it is an AC, two converters will be there. Again, power ranges will be different. Try to understand the power flow diagram for grid and home will be mostly same, but power ranges are different. Whereas, if I consider the load, if it is an AC load, same DC-DC converter is required. DC to AC converter is required, but power levels will be different. If it is a DC load, yes, only DC-DC converter is enough. If it is vehicle to vehicle, only one conductor is enough. I hope clear. Now you see, we have a generation central generation is happening, is a high voltage network. Now at the same time, earlier it was through conventional. Now what we are doing in the smart grid, we are also considering EVs and PVs. Okay, so here is the medium voltage network, EV swapping stations. To the converter, it is connected to medium level voltage. Wind we have considered, and PV also can be considered. Okay, wind, PV, the converter structures are connected. PV and wind are connected to high voltage. As I told you, EV is connected at either transmission or distribution level. Now you see here two things are there. Either aggregation of vehicles directly connected to the grid is possible. Second thing is charging station also will be considered at the distribution level, distributed generation. And third one more thing what I want to tell you is, yet lower voltage network. AC load, solar plant will be there, wind can be considered, EV can be considered, through the network also can be considered. So EV can be considered at transmission level, distribution level, and at residential level. That's what I have shown you in the starting slides. At utility level, conventional, non-conventional both will be there. At transmission distribution level, we are considering EVs along with battery storage. EV with storage, converter structure. This is for transmission, and second one is for distribution level also. Okay, and this is what happened. Now, even we can make our building is smarter. How we can make the building smarter? Even smart home you can make, smart building you can make. Now, that's the reason there are so many research papers are coming on smart home. If you want to do our PhD, there is a smart home. Can be considered. Electric vehicles are not only grid, not only smart grid, smart home, smart grid is possible with the EVs and PVs. With the EVs and PV integration, smart home is possible. With EVs and PV integration, smart apartment or smart building infrastructure also possible. So for that one, what is required? For a smart home also, what is required? Vehicle, smart home now, vehicle is required. DC-DC converter is required. Inverter structure is required. Then it can be connected to the house. But it's a building. One more thing is required. What it is? Aggregation of electric vehicles has to be done. There is an aggregator is required. After in the parking lot, all the vehicles are connected. All are connected to the aggregator circuit from the batteries. Then from there, one time it will be charged, surplus power will be given to the building. So you can make your building is smarter. How it is smarter? Not only consider EVs, you consider EVs and PVs together. Try to understand. Rooftop PV you consider, and EV you consider. So if you consider rooftop PVs, how it is? Morning time when there is a sun, it is fully EV will be PV will be charged. And if you go to your office, your electric vehicle also charged. So morning time you are charging your electric vehicle. And as well as morning time, your rooftop will be charged. When you come back from the home, from the office, or in the evening time, discharge can be done. One is through PV to EV, EV to home can be possible. So by integrating PV, EV with the grid, EV, PV with the home, or EV, PV with the building, so you can make it smarter. By including converters. So here converters also plays a major role. Okay, so smart home is possible, smart building is possible, smart grid also possible. As I told you, it parts on the services. I told you grid services. It is unidirectional service possible, bidirectional is possible. Okay, vehicle to grid, only vehicle to grid is possible, or vehicle to grid, grid to vehicle also possible. So what we have the services? We have services of spinning reserve, grid regulation is there, peak shaving, load balancing, you may call it as load leveling, grid regulation is possible, then reactive power compensation can be possible, and renewable energy support is possible. Try to understand, we have services of spinning reserve, entirely what I mean to say, load balancing, reactive power management, load balancing is possible, and we can integrate with the renewable energy sources. With the help of these services, what we are achieving what is our objective is? Our objective is load profile optimization we are doing. Try to understand. By doing the grid regulation, by doing load leveling, with the help of EVs and PV integrations, our main motto is we are doing load profile optimization. We are doing that means load scheduling is very easier. Load optimization is easier without going for new plant constructions or new investment on the new power plants. So we can generate the revenues or we can optimize the load profile. Okay. And by considering it, revenue is generated. So cost is minimized. We are not depending upon new power plants. Load optimization, if you are able to do, load profile optimization, if you are able to do with the help of V2G technologies or with integration of EVs and PVs. Load optimization we are doing, that means cost we are minimizing. If you are considering the clean power, try to understand, electric vehicles and PVs are clean power. By considering the clean power, carbon emission is reduced, carbon emission is minimized. If carbon emission is minimized and cost is minimized, load profile optimization if you are doing, in the sense revenue is maximized and losses are minimized, that means you are optimizing the load profile, minimizing the cost, and you are generating the revenue, maximizing the revenue. Carbon emission is minimized. If carbon emission is minimized, efficiency obviously it will be improved. So cost efficiency is improved and cost emission is optimized. So obviously reliability will be improved. That means, so clean air we are getting, emission from the emission, clean air object we are getting, reliability is improved. That means safe and secure power we are getting, clean power transportation is possible, and stability is possible. Load profile optimization we are doing, that means reactive power compensation, peak shaving, load leveling, grid regulation, everything is possible with the help of these objectives. Okay. And but there are some constraints are there. What it is, if you want to go ahead with this, availability of EV, driver behavior obviously, EV charging and discharging rate, how fast it is charging, how fast it is discharging. So here the batteries play a major role. What are the batteries you are considering? See, when you want to consider EV or PV with the integration of grid, basic thing is charging infrastructure play a major role. And second thing is the converter structures play a major role. DC-DC converters or DC-AC converters. Not only that, whatever you have the battery storage, energy storage, it play a very crucial role. So how fast it is charging, how fast it is discharging, that matters a lot. And how the SOC, state of charge, battery charge limitation, how much it is. EV owners, aggregation with other vehicles, and electricity rate, system power balance, power equipment, and charger capacitor. These are all our constraints. If you're able to maintain these constraints, then load optimization, cost minimization, emission minimization, carbon emission reduction in the carbon emission, and you are maximizing the revenue, losses are reduced, efficiency is improved, emissions are reduced, and reliability is improved. Okay, so these services can be provided to the customers. So that is the reason, by maintaining all these, we are attracting the stakeholders. Okay, that's what you see. Earlier there was non-conventional, now renewable energy sources also, sorry, earlier it was conventional and non-renewable sources. Now we are considering renewable energy sources into the network. At the distribution level, transmission level, aggregation of EV systems we are considering, vehicle to grid we are doing. At lower network, at the medium transmission, vehicle to grid we can do. At distribution level, smart home can be done, vehicle to home. Even smart building can be done, here vehicle to vehicle, or vehicle to grid also can be possible, vehicle to building also aggregation is possible. So power flow is not only from renewable and non-renewable sources. At the transmission level, aggregation of EV charging structure is possible, aggregation V2 grid is possible, vehicle to grid possible, is becoming smarter grid. At lower level, at consumer level, vehicle to home is possible, smart home. And aggregation of vehicles, fleet, as I told you, fleet is group of vehicles, smart building is possible. a smart organization. Okay, smart building is possible. So this way can be done. As I told you, there are different electric energy storages are there. It may be batteries, or maybe mechanical batteries will be there, electrochemical batteries will be there, electrical supercapacitor, SMEs, chemical, thermal, thermochemical. There are different battery infrastructures are there. So if you want to focus on PhD, so you can see topics on demand side management, smart home papers to consider, smart grid papers to consider, demand side management, grid intelligence papers can be considered, smart building papers can be considered, okay, and battery storage, how it is, converter structures, inverter structures for EV and PV, converters for EV and PV, integration of EV and PV. There are huge chances, the scope is there. Now, just one example we will see. If you want to consider energy management strategy of a hybrid energy storage systems, if I want to consider, so there are two ways are there. Either you consider any one of the battery, consider either supercapacitor, SMES, or Li-ion batteries, or hydrogen fuel cells, anything you consider one battery. So whatever the battery storage you consider, we are using DC-DC converters. Whatever the amount of energy is available, with the help of DC-DC converters, we will boost up the amount and it is given to the motor drive, it will go to the vehicle. So two ways are there, either directly from supercapacitor you take or internal battery can be considered. Okay, so it is energy management, extra hybrid battery we are taking, or one supercapacitor you have taken, with the DC-DC converters you are taking, both will be merged together and you can give the vehicle. Battery powered EVs, if you take, there are plug-in electric vehicles are there, hybrid is there, only electric vehicles are. If it is electric vehicles, if I take, now from the batteries, it may be supercapacitor, it may be fuel cells, it may be SMES, whatever it may be, some battery you have taken, with the help of DC-DC converters and inverter structures, motor is controlled and VV will go in this series transmission. If it is a hybrid, how we are doing? It is a series only through the battery structure it is going. With the hybrid structure, how it will go? One is through the batteries it is going, DC-DC converter. To the DC-DC converter, one more thing is from the fuel tank. Fuel tank, IC engine will be there, generator will be there, and DC-DC conversion we are doing. And battery energy, fuel tank energy together, it is given to the motor control. Earlier, it was only battery-enabled vehicles if you consider. Only battery-enabled if I consider, only it is depending upon only batteries. Then it is purely depend upon charging infrastructure or how much storage is there. Charging and discharge rate of only based on batteries, your vehicle will run. So there is a problem will be there. Suddenly battery, there is outage, some problem is there. Any SOC problems are there, charging problems are there. There will be a problem. That's why people are moving for hybrid electric vehicles. If I go with hybrid electric vehicles, not only battery, if there is a problem through the battery, even fuel tank, through the fuel tank, you can go with extended range. Hybrid electrical vehicles, extended range is possible with fuel also. This is hybrid, series panel is hybrid, hybrid electric vehicles, fuel, IC engine, generator, DC-DC converter. Only, even batteries are outage, only through this process is possible. Even if fuel tank is not working, some problem is there, through the batteries it will work. If both are working very good, combinedly you can work on it. Am I clear? So hybrid electric vehicles, there is a chance of extended range of electric vehicles is possible. Okay. And here, these converter structures, inverter structures and batteries plays a major role while considering this entire controlling block. You have to design a good converter and inverter structure and batteries, okay, so that what will happen, the efficiency will be improved and rate of charge will be faster and discharge will be less. Rate of charging will be faster and discharge rate will be less, and state of charging will be very good, so that
okay,
it can help other EVs. This is the range. Now if you consider electric vehicles, now you see either gasoline can, earlier I have shown you, take a fuel tank. The structure is gasoline. Now grid you take, AC to DC charging as I told you, grid to vehicle, AC to DC, battery, electric management system. our gasoline effluent tank, IC engine, generator, both are connected with the electrical energy management unit, and it can be powered. Both the waste can be taken. Now, here there are main problems are there. There are few barriers are there. By considering VTF technologies, there are few barriers are there. What are those barriers are? If you consider market and regulation related, technology development, users engagement. If you consider market and regulation wise, the barriers are rules and business process must be clear. Try to understand, there are different vehicles are there. There are 137 vehicles are there, different ranges are there. So there is a limited coordination between the stakeholders. That is a problem. There's a battery degradation is we have to take care. We need to consider better battery infrastructure. And second thing is, there is a non-uniform communication protocols are there. We need to standardize, like how the IEEE IEC standards are there. We need to standardize, lack of standardization here you see. We need to standardize all the rules and regulations and standards has to be maintained. Technology development has to be done. It has to bring into one umbrella in such a way that there will be uniform communication protocol, the uniform standardization if you do. Then what will happen? The technology development will be better. And one more thing, battery degradation is very faster. It should not be faster. So you have to see on battery management system. Then after that, users engagement. EV fully charged or not, how much is there, how much of state of charge is there. So in that aspect, you can work on it. And one more thing, the consumer's lack of information. So awareness of VTX capabilities has to be created. And subsidies needed, yes, Government of India is giving its subsidies. Okay, so people should aware of these things. Okay, so to avoid these barriers, the rules and business must be clear. Coordination should happen between the stakeholders. So you have to work on battery management system, uniform commissioning protocols, standardization has to be worked on, and charging infrastructure, how it is happening, fully charged or not, state of charge, everything has to be done. And one more thing, main thing, with the vehicle, VTX capabilities has to be given, how it is consumer should know, or should aware these VTX capabilities. And as Government of India is giving subsidies, people should aware for what model, how much they are giving, is it good or not, what is the range, everything details you can see, procedure can be seen. Okay. If time permits, few slides I want to show on smart grid. Organization. Is it okay? Ganesh, sir? Okay. This is what we have seen. Till now, what we have seen, as per the nation, our motto is accelerated electrification of clean transportation, charging infrastructure, 21st century grid is the key contributors for safer, secure, and clean air objectives. Okay. For that one, National City Mobility Plan, what they did, they have given ambitious target of 6 to 7 million hybrid electric vehicles. So they are promoting hybrid electric vehicles. For that one, they have created FAME India scheme. Okay. So, and as per the National Smart Grid Mission, it should be a primary grid modernization should happen through either EV or PV. So next one, we need to reduce the carbon reduction, and mostly integration of renewables should happen. And we need to generate renewable power of 175 gigawatt. Then what we have seen after that slides, past architecture we have seen, architecture of the present, how the grid is, future how the grid will be, we have seen. In the past grid, we have only generation was, just I am summarizing before moving to the another topic. In the past grid, we were having only conventional sources was there. It is transmitted and distributed power. Okay. The controlling was only through telephonic controlling. But whereas if you consider present grid, not only conventional, non-conventional sources also we have considered. How it is? With the help of PVs and wind we have considered. And the power is transmitted and distributed. At the distribution level also, household level also, we are considering not only rooftop PV, EVs also now we are considering. It is the present grid. And how the information flow is, now communication networks also we are using. it is not fully controlled, maybe SCADA systems we are considering. So earlier it was manual operator, now it is the system operator. The future smarter grid, not only conventional, non-conventional, even small hydro we are taking, and in the transmission and distribution we are considering electric vehicles along with charging infrastructure, or along with charging infrastructure as well as energy storage we are considering. By considering charging infrastructure and energy storage, by considering charging infrastructure and energy storage, we are enabling the grid stability, security and reliability. Okay, at the transmission level, distribution level, we are considering. And at consumer level, not only rooftop PVs, even EV also we are considering almost all the places. Okay, so through this one, smart grid is possible by integration of EV PVs, smart home is possible, and smart building also possible. So then after that, limitations of present grid we have seen. What are the essential elements of smart grid also we have seen. Then after that, we have seen VTX technologies. Vehicle to grid is possible, vehicle to load, vehicle to vehicle, vehicle to home is possible. Then some advantages we have seen. Then after that, what we have seen? Power flow diagrams we have seen. Power flow diagram of vehicle to grid. For that one, which involves aggregation of vehicles and DC-DC converters. Inverter structures are required. Okay. Then vehicle to home, vehicle to vehicle, vehicle to load we have seen. Okay. Then we have seen what type of services we are having, what are the objective functions we have, what are the constraints we were having. There are hundreds of research papers are there in grid integration PVs. There are limited papers are there in integration of EVs. You can see smart home, smart building, demand side management is there, grid intelligence is there, energy storage, battery, some papers are there. Okay. There are numerous papers, now people are working on it. There is a high scope of smart home, smart building and EV, PV grid integration. And one more thing, converter topologies are converters for integration of EV and PV, or EV, RPV, EV and PV also can be considered. And inverter topologies, batteries required. Okay, so you can work on the batteries also. Then, just some 10 more minutes, if time permits, I want to show you how the smart grid, it has started, what is the vision, what is the mission, how the theater structure of smart grid. Just I will give you the basics. It will be helpful to you for the next sessions. So I thought of giving what is the scope. Organizer, is it okay? Shall I continue, sir?
Hello.
Oh, yes, hello. Sir. Continue. Continue on the session. Okay. 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 Now we have seen the barriers. We have seen EV infrastructures. We have seen as well as power flow diagrams. We have seen and what are the constraints? What are the services we have seen? Present, past grid, and future grid we have seen. So now, why we are considering it? What is the actual vision of a smart grid? What is the mission? For that one, what plans we have taken now? So I want to show you just the basic details. So smart grid vision for India is transforming the Indian power sector into a secure, adaptive, sustainable, digitally enabled ecosystem. That means secure power is required. It should be adaptive in nature. And the power should be sustainable for longer periods and digitally enabled. Okay. Which provides reliable and quality energy for all the active participation of stakeholders. Try to understand. We want to transform the Indian power sector into a secure power and adaptive, sustainable, digitally enabled ecosystem that provides reliable and quality energy for all with the active participation of stakeholders. Now, what is a secured power? Now, you see, vehicle to grid you do, PV to grid you do, or energy storage elements you consider. By demand side management, grid intelligence, and clean power and clean transportation, we are getting the secured power. And it is in adaptive in nature. We are not depending upon, if you consider the smart grid, we are not depending upon new power plant investment. Whatever the power we have taken, it is sustainable power because of renewable energy systems integration. By integrating renewable energy systems into a grid, it is energy sustainable. And one more thing, what you are doing in the smart grid, digital communication we are doing. Earlier it was electrochemical or electromechanical. Now what you are doing, it is digital communication we are considering. It is two-way communication. That's why it is digitally enabled ecosystem. So by considering secure, adaptive and sustainable and digitally enabled ecosystem, which provides reliable and quality energy to all the stakeholders. Okay. So we are transforming our power sector into a secure, adaptive, sustainable and digitally enabled ecosystem, which provides reliable and quality energy to all the stakeholders. For that one, digital communication and EVs, PVs, we are considering integration. Okay. Now, how the NSGM structure, National Smart Grid structure, it is of three-tier structure is there. In the first tier, there is a Ministry of Power will be there. Try to understand. The chairperson will be, okay, Ministry of Power is the governing council. The governing council is Ministry of Power. This is a tier one. Now, under tier one, next tier two is consists of, there is an empowered committee will be there from Power Grid, and there is a technical committee. Empowered committee and technical committee. Technical committee is mostly Central Electricity Authority of India, there is a Power Grid. Technical committee will be mainly from the Power Grid. But empowered committee is from the Secretary of Ministry of Power. Try to understand. Tier 1 was the Ministry of Power is the governing council. Tier 2 consists of two committees. One is empowered committee. These financial things are discussed. And technical committee will see the rules and regulation, regularities and the technical issues. Everything will be headed by the chairperson of CEA. Coming to the tier 3, NSGM project energy unit together. And it is Smart Grid Knowledge Center and consultants and advisory bodies will be there. Now this project management unit consists of, there are four units are there: policy, planning and monitoring, data management and cyber security, R&D technology standard unit, projects and empowered committee. The technical committee will give the inputs to the empowered committee. Technical committee will give technical details to the empowered committee. Under the empowered committee, NSGM project management unit will be there. Under this unit, we have policy and planning and monitoring unit. Under policy planning, only FAME India has come. Data management, cyber security, communication network, demand side management, grid intelligence, these are things plays a role. And R&D technology, this is smart meters, everything, smart meters, aggregation of grid intelligence. Try to understand policy, planning and monitoring under this. Now we are considering EVs and PV infrastructures, okay? And the fast adaptation of FAME scheme, Digital India scheme, these are all the policies will come under here. One unit will be looking after it. Second unit looking after communication protocols, infrastructure protocol, or information technology, or IT related, or cyber security, data management, SCADA controlling and monitoring, will be done by this unit. Third one is how to improve the technology, R&D related, like by aggregating the intelligence. Second thing is smart meter infrastructure, phase measuring units, okay, the power quality measurements, harmonic analysis considerations. So everything will be taken care by R&D units, like with the existing system, how to make it restructuring. Then fourth one is the project and training capacity building, okay. Considering state level distribution, one second. Okay, sorry. So now, once you consider this type 3 structure, after that, there is a state level will be there. Now, state level, there is a chair will be there, Secretary of Power. Under them, there is a distribution utilities will be there, smart grid cell will be there, consumers will be there. For entire thing, now R&D will be, there is a smart grid knowledge center will be there, consultants will be there, advisory bodies will be there. So, they will monitor these R&D and projects. Okay. This entire thing is the two-way network. Any problems are there, it will be communicated through these people, and it will be two-way communication, it will be segregated. Okay. our main mission is, what is the scope is, deployment of smart meters and advanced metering infrastructure. Then substation renovation and modernization by employing gas insulated substations. Development of distributed generations, that means rooftop. Real-time monitoring and control, that's what our mission now. Provision of harmonic filters, creation of EV charging infrastructure, now they are trying to create. Development of medium-sized microgrids. Present smart grid mission is deployment of smart meters and advanced metering infrastructure into the present grid. Substation renovation they will do, and modernization with the employment of gas insulated substations. Then development of distributed generation in the form of rooftop PVs. Then real-time monitoring and controlling they are doing. Then EV charging infrastructures and medium-sized microgrids. Now, till now how the journey was happened, there is a smart grid task force is there and the India forum was there. So what they have done, they have created a group under the Ministry of Power, the policies they have discussed under this smart grid task force. Then in the forum, it is non-profit voluntary consortium of public inputs, stakeholder inputs they have taken. Then based on that one, they have designed some projects. There are 11 smart grid projects are there, one smart grid city pilots are there. So 50% funding will be support, they will get from the Ministry of Power. Okay. So these are the things already you might be knowing. So 11 projects, they have started in 2013. Then smart standards, they have finalized by standards of this one, August 15. Then regulations were started, and this way flow has happened. Just I will show you. Smart grid projects are 5 are there, Chandigarh, level 2 are there. Tiruvananthapuram, Kochi is there, Jharkhand is there, Odisha is there, but Kochi is not in functional because of some issues. Only 4 were in active. And smart grid pilot projects are under IPDS, restructuring of accelerated power development reforms program. There are 11 are there. One is in Ajmer, Assam, Mysore, Himachal Pradesh, Puducherry, then Tripura, even Telangana, Haryana, Gujarat, West Bengal, and Manesar. Okay. Even one is there in IIT, Kanpur also. This is knowledge center. So what they have implemented here, I had given advanced metering infrastructure, building using advanced metering infrastructure, it can be possible or not, implemented or not. Peak load management are they using or not. Power quality management can be done. Outage management can be done. So they are mainly considering in these 11 projects, before considering this advanced metering infrastructure or smart meters, in the as a whole, before they want to implement, they have started with first some places they have considered, try to understand. So 5 areas they have considered, there they have implemented at subdivision level. Then they can extend it for the entire India. And what they did, metering infrastructure also, they have considered different places, they have considered Ajmer, Assam, some places. What they consider, advancing metering infrastructure, they try to implement. Building can be done with that automated one. And peak load management, is it taking or not? Power quality management, is it taking or not? Outage management, is it taking or not? Microgrid generation is possible or not? With these 11 centers, they are doing. So if they succeed here, if there is any challenges are happen, any problems are there, they try to figure out. There is a QCI is there, Quality Council of India. There is a Quality Council of India will be there. They will monitor it. And after monitoring, one city succeed. Now they will extend it for one city. They will check in that city. If it is okay, they will extend it to one district level. Then they will extend it to one state. In the slowly, what they are doing, first they have started with the centers, knowledge centers. R&D they are doing. They are designing the policies. R&D they are doing. Then they are adding the smart knowledge centers. Then slowly, they have developed 11 centers. There they have implemented. Slowly they are seeing the results and the quality management, peak load management, how it is taking, metering can be done or not, billing can be done or not. So everything they are checking. Once it is done, they are extending it to cities, then the district level and state level they want to do. In that way, so these things were started. Okay. Now, our mission is NSGM to plan and monitor the implementation of the policies. First planning and implementation, first one. Second one, project management unit, which is housed in Power Grid. They need to take own the responsibilities, functionalities, and the total outlay budget was 980 crores. With the support of 338 crores. That's why the 12th plan, 2015. Now, what are the key challenges? Pilot stage, there is a lack of skills, readiness in the utilities. Initial response, there was no response from the industries. due to lack of preparedness. The standardization of smart meters, advanced metering infrastructure was not there. Utilities are coming with the different standards, a different set of specifications with the smart meters. Integration with the existing IT system, there is a lack of skilled IT people. There is a lack of IT people. Okay, and even when tendering was happened, the lower one, L1 costs are very high with respect to the standard cost. So lack of skills are there. Readiness is not there in the utilities. If I want to implement smart grid in the restructuring I want to do, there is no readiness in the utility level. Industries were not that much prepared. Standards are not there. Meters, different standards were there. So now what we are doing at this stage, current stage, testing the facilities for smart meters. Interoperability issues. What it means, the communication network and energy network merging or integrating with the existing system, is it possible or not? So everything they are trying to do, adoption of smart grid regularities. So everything, their skill development for the staff, consumer engagement they are doing. Okay. Join IT&D losses. 35 million smart meters installation was done December 2019. Four full scale projects are there, because out of which Kochi is not operational. Five are there, four is now operational, 596 crores were approved, 180 is given by NSDM. PVs by 2022, 40,000 megawatt of rooftop has to happen. Efficient use of existing sources should happen.
Excuse me, sir.
Sir.
Can I ask some questions related? The participants has posted some questions here.
Okay.
So chat one box, question.
Sir, chat box I will open. Where is it?
No, I will read out because it is posted on WhatsApp, bro.
Okay, tell me, sir. Thank you.
So there is a question by the Lenin, sir, that what are the applications of AI in this topic?
Sir, artificial intelligence, na, sir, you can consider optimization whenever the controlling is there, optimization is there. So artificial intelligence based DC-DC converters or inverter topologies or maybe electric vehicles. So when you are integrating it, AI plays a major role, sir. Artificial intelligence can be taken for grid connected PV, grid connected EV system. So you can take it. Like suppose if you take, you are interconnecting EV and PV. If you take the PV system, MPPT, artificial intelligence based MPPT system will be there. So you can make it automation. There is a controlling communication protocol is there. You can make it artificial intelligence based communication protocol can be done. Suppose automatically how much charge is there, how much discharge is there, automatic levels it can say. So intelligent electric vehicles also can make with, but it will be costlier. If you see the point of view, like communication point of view, you can artificial intelligence can be given. Even performance quality point of view, one is communication point of view, artificial intelligence can be implemented. Second one is quality point of view. One is communication, second one is energy. Try to understand, sir. Two things are there. Communication point of view, artificial intelligence can be implemented. Even energy point of view, you can implement artificial intelligence. There are some papers are there, sir. You can understood, sir.
There is another question from the Jaideep Shah, sir. Why there is a need of a charging station at the transmission level? Will it be V2G or G2V?
Okay. That is true. Actually, sir, suppose if I want to boost up anything, generation, high amount of voltage if I want to transmit, if you need any system like distributed generation, if I want to go ahead with high amount of power charging, if I want to do, you can consider mostly transmission not required. As he said, distribution level only, if you consider, that will be enough. That is true. Distribution level, it is enough. Transmission level not required. Distribution level, it is enough. Fine. That is okay.
Thank you, sir. One more question. What are the key factors to be considered while designing a charging station and how it will be universally implemented? Means different EV manufacturers have different V and I levels. Other electrical parameter as well for charging their car. So how widely charging station can be used in all EV?
That's for sir. Here you see in this slide, as I told, slide is visible now, sir. See, electrical vehicle charging infrastructure, it can be done either AC way or DC way. There are different levels are there. So based on, suppose if you consider at home level, only 120 volts, this much level, 240 volts, this much will be available. if you go for DC fast charging, people has to standardize, people has to consider, there will be a provision will be there. That's what people are considering. Either 220 volts like fuel. Now you see speed fuel is there, petrol is there, normal petrol is there, isn't it? I want to just interrelate. Speed petrol is there, normal petrol is there. In the same way, speed charging will be there or normal charging. Like even DC fast charging, 80 amperes one will be there, 200 amperes one will be there. Based on that one, cost and time charging level will be different. Okay. So now they are standardizing the values, how much voltage, how much current, how much power should be required. This is what you see. Voltage is power, current. For this level, I can go up to for 1 hour charge, 120 microsecond go. If I same voltage, but 100 kilowatt and 200 amperes if I consider, I can go up to 300 miles. So now people are designing 2 to 3 infrastructures, either AC level 2, or DC level 1, DC level 2, based on 3 charging infrastructures will be there, like how the speed petrol, how the normal petrol. In the same way, if you consider both levels, it is user friendly. Which one you want, that can be, you can go there, you can have it. So now they are standardizing the values.
Okay, thank you. Suresh sir, very nice session conducted by you. The participant has posted the review also, that very nice session on the WhatsApp group. Okay. Thank you, sir, for a very good session. On the behalf of Department of Electrical Engineering, KK Wagh Institute of Engineering Education and Research, Nashik, I would like to thank Dr. Suresh Mikkeli, sir, for a wonderful session. So hope we will continue this coordination and this integration together in future also.
Definitely, sir. Thank you, sir, once again for the organizers as well as management and the participants. Thank you for patient listening. Yeah. Much time, 2 hours. Thank you, one and all.
Sir, can you share the PPT, please, in the PDF format?
Definitely, sir. I will email you, sir. I will email
you. Yeah. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Participants are requested that you continue for the session 3 on the same link. Okay, there will be session number 4 at 3 p.m. So you will continue through the same session, and it is request to all the participants that please mute your mic when you are talking with the others. Just now we have some 2-3 echoes related to this. I will not name the participants, but there are the disturbance due to the participants' mic. So I'm requesting the participants that please mute your mic while doing the session. Okay. And one more thing, that is a Google Classroom. I have created the Google Classroom yesterday and share the link on the group. Those who have not joined yet, please join, because all assessment will be taken in the Google Classroom. And based on all grading policies and all material will be posted in the Google Classroom only. Okay, so you have to download that material from that Google Classroom link. Okay, so please join there and submit the quiz on time, quiz and feedback in on time, so that there will be smooth conduction of the workshop. Okay, and one more thing, after submitting your quiz, first there is a submit button, and second is the turn in or handed in button is there. Okay, turn in or handed in. So many participants are submitting the quiz, but they are not pressing the button of turn in or handed in. Unless you handed in, I cannot see your score at my side. Okay, so please make it handed in or turn in at the end. After submitting the quiz, there is a button of handed in or turn in. So please check that. Thank you. We'll meet at the 3 p.m. Thank you.